You're on.
I'm on now. There you go. Well, we want to welcome everybody here this morning. A gorgeous day. We're in the midst of June. Blows my mind that it just keeps flying by. And, you know, the Smiths are here and they're already thinking, okay, well, we'll be back in Florida and before you know it. Yeah, exactly. Well, it's supposed to be nice today. Let's see what we got. Some friendly. Don't forget, if you're a visitor here, please fill out that white card. Any prayer requests, the pink card, make sure you put those in the offering as well. The yellow card is, again, just anything for me. Also, don't forget, following the service, we are having Sunday school. Howard's leading our Sunday school downstairs. We've got little snacks and stuff, so come down there and join us for that. Tomorrow is our Power Book Monday. So again, we invite everybody. It starts at 12:30, and we are going through Anxious for Nothing. It is a terrific book, and so we've been going through it, so you're all invited, unless you got to go to work, but come anyways. Don't forget, Wednesday night, we got our kick with our young kids, and then we also have, 412.
Actually, we are meeting this week, yeah.
Oh, it's still on.
Yeah.
We're still
Sorry.
On, we're still running.
Sorry.
That's okay, you know.
Yeah.
All right, that's good. Don't forget our adult Bible study. We're going through the apostles. Kind of interesting, just hitting each one and just what it says about them scripturally and then what lessons we can learn from them as well. Yay. Board meeting, don't forget, you're all invited to join us for all that fun that we have. You know, but we are, seriously, you are invited to come and just see how we're running the finances of church and all those things, or if you ever have any questions. Also this Saturday, Howard leading our men's prayer breakfast, which is always a great, he does such a tremendous job for that. We're talking about our mission of the month, and this month is Grace Centers of Hope. And again, that little black thing back there that we can put money, no, I'm sorry, that's not it. It's the, Denny always stands in front of it and I can never see it. You know, it's that, you know, just to throw change, loose change or whatever, just an additional giving to one of our missions. And just to explain what they do, I think we have a short little film on this.
How are you today, sir?
Our dream was to have a safe, secure, and loving haven for the women and children impacted by abuse, homelessness, and addiction. Welcome to the William A. Davis Women and Children's Center, a place that exists thanks to you. As Grace Centers of Hope does not accept any government funding, allowing our programs to be rooted in the gospel of Jesus Christ, and giving us the opportunity to offer our programs at zero charge to our residents. The first element of providing security and love is through preparing a warm, nutritious, and tasty meal 3 times a day, 7 days a week. We are able to serve over 125,000 meals a year. This is all served in our sprawling cafeteria. Another staple of care we provide the women and children at Grace Centers of Hope is accommodating them with a warm, comfy, and fully updated living quarters. They also have an equally spacious and fully functional bathroom. When the ladies are not in class, eating breakfast, lunch, or dinner, or enjoying their morning routines in their personal bedrooms, they need a place to let their hair down and enjoy themselves. Socialization is key for building impactful, healthy relationships, growing the idea of fellowship, and even healing those inner hurts that only others can help bring to the surface. What better way to do it than within a building that feels like home? The most important aspect of our building is the classroom. This is where the transformation takes place. The women are in several classes throughout the day that range from learning about codependence, abortion recovery, sexual abuse therapy, learning about their first families, and the impact that they've had, and so much more. This is where women go from being victims to victors, from being hopeless to hopeful. Beyond the classes, the women are also given a full-time case manager that helps them personally apply the lessons they learn in class and help them develop their recovery strategies and plans. They also help with arranging court appearances, working with Child Protective Services, and any other outside services they may need help managing during their stay at Grace Centers of Hope. Many of the women who enter our programs are single mothers who are seeking help. And in order for them to receive that help, they do need alone time during the day to attend classes, study, and meet with their case managers. As a result, they need a daycare for their children that they can trust. That help is offered in the form of our new and improved daycare, located not 100 feet from the front entrance of our women's center. A place to be kids again and enjoy the simple pleasures of that time in their lives, while also creating that safe haven that some of these kids have never experienced before in their lives. We don't just value security, love, and safety. We also value growing our residents in their careers and education. Our goal is to set them up for success after the program. This means making sure that no woman who completes the program completes without a high school diploma or the equivalency of one in a GED. Not only is our GED program offered, but toward the end of their one-year program, a focus begins on developing their careers. This is where they build their resumes, practice interview skills, and prepare to enter the workforce to become a productive member of society again. This is all done with zero cost to the resident. This is all done through no government funding. We receive all of our funding through people like you. Once finished with the one-year program, those women are offered an even bigger opportunity to move on to our two-year aftercare program, where they will live in a beautiful home with roommates who have also graduated the one-year program and are there for support, friendship, and accountability. In the end, within 3 years, a woman can go from being broken, hurt, and hopeless to being renewed, restored, and revived. It's a miracle that we get to see every day, carried out through our programs by God, through bringing us people like you who stand with us as hope prevails.
So cool. So this is one of our missions that we have, and like we said, we have the jar back there to add that. Also, we have a birthday. Jeanette Worley, happy birthday. Hers is today, so happy birthday to her. Does she get a cake? No, I don't think so, since she makes them all. So, Tim Barker, I'm gonna give it back here. I don't need them eating it while we're trying to get things done here today. So again, a happy birthday to you, Timmy boy. So let's go to Lord in prayer. Our dear precious Heavenly Father, we just come to you thanking you for who you are. We rejoice in your name. We rejoice that we can be here today, that you've given us another day of life. We just ask now that we focus on you, that our hearts are open to your word, to the song service, to the sermon, to the meditation, to everything that we do here today. Let our focus just be on you. Let us feel your presence, dear Heavenly Father. We just thank you so much that we can be here with family and friends just to worship you. We honor you and we give you all the glory. It's your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand and sing our opening worship song.
Good morning, again. Ever since I took AP Psychology in high school, I've always loved learning about the human brain, how it works, what causes certain things to happen, and the symptoms of each. Recently, I've been looking into uncommon emotions that we have as humans but don't really know the names to. Have you ever had the feeling as an adult that as you take on more and more responsibilities, you wish you could just be a child again with no responsibilities? That emotion's called liberosis. Try this feeling on for size. You get in your head and carry out replaying an argument over and over again, thinking of different ways you could have won that argument. That's called Juska. And my favorite one to explore is called Sonder. It's where you come to the realization, normally walking down the street, that each individual person you come across, whether it's family, friend, or stranger, has their own identity and experiences that they have gone through that are just as vivid and complex as your own. Each person's perspective is based on what they have gone through and can all be right depending on the way they look at the same thing. A great example of this is a story about a painter, a preacher, and a cowboy who all went to visit the Grand Canyon. As they stood at the rim, taking in the grand rock formations, they each gave a proclamation describing their view. The painter cried out, "Ah, what a beautiful scene to paint." The preacher proclaimed, "What a wonderful example of the handiwork of God." The cowboy glanced around and mused, "What a terrible place to lose a cow." In church, we also bring our own perspectives on life. We all come from different backgrounds and have different experiences and get different lessons every single day. But God brings us all together through one point, through Jesus. He is the one single thing we all have in common, and He is the one we have agreed to obey. Just as Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 says, "For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons and daughters of God through faith." Let's do our best to minimize our differences in opinion and focus on the truth we all have faith in. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn it, but to save it through Him. Amen. Gentlemen. Bow with me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before You today to remember You sending Your Son as a sacrifice for our sins. We remember Your broken body and shed blood with these emblems before us as a constant reminder of what happened on that cross. Please help us never take for granted everything You have done for us, and bless this communion to our spirits. In Jesus' name, amen. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of Me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes." Luke chapter 6, verse 38 says, "Give, and will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." And as always, well, I was visiting Grandma and Grandpa yesterday, and it's just like I always do. And Grandma asked if I had meditation this week, and I said, yeah. I was like, does that mean you're going to be picking on us? Well, because you asked. Yeah, I am. And I found a little story that kind of reminds me of them. A guy stops at a little cake shop ran by an elderly couple. He asks for a cup of coffee, and the old man who was working the counter turns to the kitchen and says, "Sweetie, a cup of coffee for the gentleman, please." The man found that rather cute, and deciding he could use some cake with his coffee, decided to order a slice. The elderly man turned to the kitchen again and proclaimed, "Love of my life, a slice of cake too, please." The man found that adorable, and deciding to see that just one more time, asked for some cookies. And just like that, "Oh, reason of my existence, some cookies too." And the man was done, and after the man was done and was paying the bill, he turned to the senior and said, "It's rather adorable how you two can call each other cute nicknames like that. You don't see that much nowadays." The old man looked at the boy, then towards the kitchen, and whispered to the man, "Nah, I just forgot the old lady's name 20 years ago." Bow with me in offering prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you again to thank you for your faithfulness and that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and you have given us so much out of your mercy. We offer these tithes today to worship you. Please extend and multiply its reach into the community so that all can know you and call you Father. And all God's people said, amen.
Some words on a page that show nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters where no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you just live in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset, in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me. You're amazing, faithful. Love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me with hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love?
But I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees.
You're everything I need. You're amazing, faithful. Love's open door. When I'm empty, you feel me with hunger for more. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. It's who you are.
couple of things before we start that I failed to mention, but I have a lovely wife that reminds me constantly of all the things I failed to mention. First of all, I know I mentioned it's Jeanette's birthday, and I just said we didn't bring. We did. I should have presented then, but we did give her a card and just to thank her so much for what she does. It wasn't like, hey, you ain't getting nothing. We did give her something. So, and just for all the great things that she does for us. Also, just kind of a neat day yesterday. Both the girls' softball and the boys' softball team won regionals, which was so cool for Algonac. Yes. The girls play the quarterfinals Tuesday in Adrian. The boys played their quarterfinals yesterday as well, and they lost in the quarterfinals. But still, to go that far was, it was, for the girls, it was amazing. They played four games, two games in districts, two games in regionals. And up to this time, I think they've scored close to 80 runs and hasn't given up a run yet. So, yeah, it's amazing how well they're doing. So I had to make sure I mentioned that. We just want to welcome everybody here again, just so we can come here with family and friends and worship the Lord. We're going to continue our series, Broken Chains. And today we're going to talk about the mountain of freedom. And we're going to continue in the book of Exodus. And today we will be in chapters 19 into chapter 20. But of course, there's always that big question that hopefully we can answer by the end here today. The law was the basis of Israel's freedom from slavery from Egypt, as well as a foundation of the blessings that God wanted to give them. And the question is, why did God introduce these laws in such an intimidating and frightening way? Because he will do this. In about 3 weeks, which is unbelievable in my mind again, our nation is going to have a special celebration. It's going to be the 4th of July, Independence Day. And this will be the 246th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And we need to know, as you look at that document, and I always say about that document, basically, it was a very simple document that will create the United States, but it's also a declaration of war. But the key that it has is what they believed in. And one part that we should know, it says, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We are a nation of free people. And what's interesting is that if you go to our the nation's capital, we'll see the importance of that freedom is all part of what Moses received on Mount Sinai, those Ten Commandments. Anywhere you go in D.C., you can find scripture or something relating to this. As you go to the Capitol building, I think by the House of Representatives, there's a huge statue of Moses holding the Ten Commandments. If you go into the Supreme Court, these big, beautiful oak doors have the carving of the Ten Commandments. And so, the question is, why would they put all these things in our Capitol that you think that everybody wants to get rid of? Because as a nation of free people, our leaders, our founding fathers, intended to build our freedom upon God's law that was given at Mount Sinai. And so our story today, we find the people of Israel at the foot of Mount Sinai. If you remember, if we've been going through this series, they have left Egypt, and now they got to the Red Sea, and they crossed the Red Sea. And as soon as they crossed that Red Sea, they are now going to Mount Sinai. This is where they received the Ten Commandments and all the rest of God's commandments. But I love the very first words of these commandments. And it goes, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. They've been taken away from Egypt, where they were slaves. And now God is going to proclaim them a free people. God is the one who's going to make them free. Now, they're on their way to the promised land. They knew this. Here they go. This land of freedom. But on their way, they have to make a little pit stop. And that pit stop is going to be Mount Sinai. This is where they're going to receive the law. And this law is going to be the foundation of their blessings and the freedom that they're going to receive because they're going to be a people of God. In the book of Deuteronomy, it tells us this. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. If you obey the Lord your God. You'll be blessed in the city. You'll be blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed. And the crops of your land and the young of your livestock. The calves of your herds and the lambs of your flock. Your baskets and your kneading will be blessed. The Lord will grant you that the enemies who rise up against you will be defeated before you. They'll come at you. I love this. They'll come at you from one direction, but they're going to flee in seven different directions. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hands to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land that he is giving you. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on an oath, if you keep the commands of the Lord, your God, and walk in obedience to him. You see, God was promising the Israelites that his law would be the foundation of their freedom. The foundation of their freedom and the blessings as a people of God. There's a book called None of These Diseases. And it's written by S.I. McMillan. And it's kind of an interesting book because it focuses on God's promises in the law that he gave Israel. If they would obey these laws, they wouldn't experience a lot of the diseases that other nations, especially the Egyptians that they just left. And it was pretty interesting because this author goes into great detail on pointing out the diseases Israel would be spared if they obeyed all the laws that God had given them. A lot of people think they just got the Ten Commandments. There's a whole bunch of laws that God has given them. For example, as this man wrote, he says, in our present culture, the idea of sexual purity is being laughed at, basically. And yet, in God's law, it was something taken very, very seriously. And what has been the result of nations ignoring what God had put down in his law? They said since the 1960s, the number of sexual transmitted diseases has just skyrocketed, gone out of control, and it's a major health concern. And then there's laws that God gave Moses was concerning how to stay clean. All about sanitation. You think, well, why would God put all that in there? Well, because a lot of people didn't understand that. We take for granted today in our culture because we understand such things. But that has not always been the case. Back in 1840, there was a medical center in Europe, in Vienna. It had a disease or illness that was a place to go when sick. And was basically the cutting edge at that time for medical care. In that day, there was a young doctor that was stationed there. He's still there. There you go. And his name was Ignaz Semmelweis. And his area of expertise was the maternity ward at the hospital. But there was a problem that really was bothering him in this maternity ward. The percentage of death was extremely high. One of every six women who came in there was dying. They called it childbed fever. And nobody could figure out why such a high rate of death in this maternity ward. And so he studied it. And he was just watching, observing what was going on. He was observing what were the doctors doing in this maternity ward. And he discovered that most of these physicians, when they first got to the hospital, they would go down to the morgue and they would examine these dead bodies for study. And then they would leave there, because there was no rubber gloves at that time, and they didn't believe you had to wash your hands, they would leave there and go to the maternity ward and examine these women. And pretty soon, he felt something's not right here. And so he instituted a strict regimen that after you leave the morgue, you had to wash your hands. And immediately, the death rate fell to about 1%. Well, you'd think that would be great news. You would think that this would be wonderful news. But the doctors were mad at him because he was taking up too much of their time of washing their hands, so he gets fired. So he goes to another hospital, does the same thing, saves all these lives, and again, they say, you got to go. You're causing us all kinds of grief. Not until Dr. Pasteur came up with his germ theory did people realize how important it was, especially doctors, to wash hands. Things that we know so well today. Wash your hands. And so, if we look, though, at God's law, way back, 1,000 years ago, and the law said, whoever touches a human corpse will be unclean for 7 days. If you read a little further down, it talks about this whole cleansing process that they would have to go through. The people of Israel observed proper laws. They didn't know why they did. They didn't know anything about plagues or diseases or what caused it. All they knew is that this is what God asked them to do. So now we have God bringing them to the mountain, and God now giving them the law that would be the basis of their freedom for their people. And if they obeyed God's law, they would remain a free people. And I like this next part, because just before he gave Israel the law, just before he was going to give them all this, God does something kind of odd. God tells Moses this. Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready for the third day. Because on that day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not approach the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain is going to be put to death. They are to be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on them. No animal should be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they approach the mountain. God put boundaries on what was going to happen. Anyone who touched the mountain was supposed to die. Israel had come to the mountain where they had their freedom. They're going to get their freedom based on God's law. And freedom should be celebrated. You think about that. They're here. They've been in slavery for so many years. Now they're going to the promised land. Now they're at this mountain. And now they're going to be able to get their law to set them apart from every nation in the world. They are going to be free. And you'd think it would be kind of a neat thing. You'd think there would be a huge celebration. Freedom usually causes that celebration. That's what we do every 4th of July. Why? Because we celebrate our freedom. And there's fireworks. And it's such a cool night when we do those things. Well, God did the same kind of thing. He kind of set some fireworks off on Mount Sinai. And it says, when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off. I don't think there's anybody worried about touching that mountain now. They backed up way, way far back. And they said to Moses, hey, you go speak to us. We'll listen. But do not let God speak to us because we're going to die. You go do it. You go talk to him. We'll listen to you, buddy. Just go. Please. And so, here's the fireworks that God has set off. But these people are so scared, they're so frightened, that they're backing up. Moses, this is on you. This is a place of freedom. This is the foundation of what God is trying to do. But the big question is, where? Where's the celebration? Why are these people so afraid? Where's the excitement? They're going, we're going to get these new laws. Where's the festivities? You'd think this would be one huge big party. You'd think the barbecue would be going. Where are the brats and the burgers and the hot dogs going? We're having a celebration because God is going to give us this new law. Why on earth would God create a threatening and scary atmosphere for giving the law? You'd think this would be a huge celebration. Why would God do it this way? Why did he scare the pants off these people, have them trembling, have them run back and say, Moses, you're going to have to deal with this. A law that was intended for freedom and a blessing to Israel. Why this way? I can think of maybe a few reasons here. First of all, God knew their hearts. At one point when they're in the desert, Moses stopped them and told them this. Never forget how you provoked the Lord your God to anger in the desert. From the day you left Egypt until you arrived at this mountain, you have been rebellious against the Lord. God knew their hearts. He knew that their hearts could be hardened very easily. He knew how rebellious these people can get so quickly. He knew that they provoked God himself by their behavior. And so when God brought them to the base of this mountain to receive the commandments, he puts on a real scary light show here with the thunder and the lightning and the shaking of this mountain. Basically, he was telling these people, I'm God, and you're not, and you better get used to it. He was telling them these commandments he was about to give them were commandments, not suggestions. He's not telling them, hey, you know what? I'm going to throw these out, and you guys all vote on it. Why don't you guys create a committee, get all together, and start Xing out and come up with some ideas, and we'll sit down and talk about it. It didn't happen that way. No voting. What do you think, idea? You get to pick and choose what you want. It doesn't happen. Those were God's commandments that he gave. It was all or nothing. If they wanted God's freedom, they had to take God's law. That's just the way it is. All of them. But why say that to them in that way? Why through a mountain that was shaking and lightning? Well, because people tend to bend the rules to their own advantage. Let me ask you this. Have you ever bent the rules a little bit? Maybe said, well, this is, I found a technicality. Goodness gracious, a loophole. We used to say that as coaches, especially in Florida, when FHSAA, the Florida High School Athletic, they would spend months and months and months and months on creating new laws for coaches and different things. And the coaches would sit down, and it would take us maybe somewhere between 7 to 12 minutes of finding a loophole and a way to get around those things. It's sometimes our nature to do those things. I'll tweak it a little bit my own way. God knew the Israelites. God knows our hearts. That's one reason he made such an imposing, frightening display at Mount Sinai. The second reason God may have done it this way, he knew Israel's freedom under the law was really not total freedom. Reading that text, and I've read it a lot, something struck me again, and I hope you notice this, that at this mountain, they were not allowed to touch the mountain when God was there. They're not allowed to touch this mountain. And the question is why? And the question is, who is at the top of this mountain? God is at top of the mountain. In so many cultures during that time, these different nations would build these huge temples, these huge buildings, because they wanted to get close to their gods. They felt the bigger it is, the higher it is, the closer they can get to God. Which kind of makes sense, I guess, if you're back then. Well, if we want to get close to God, let's build something to get close to God. But God didn't want Israel to build any altars like that, because Israel didn't belong where God was. God was totally holy. God was totally pure. And they weren't. Even after they arrived and got the law, their sin made them unable to get really close to God. The law couldn't make them acceptable to God. I like what the Apostle Paul wrote. It is evident that no one is justified before God by the law. for the righteous shall live by faith. In other words, he's saying the law could help you be a better person, but it couldn't get you closer to God. I like what one person wrote. He said, the Ten Commandments will keep you out of jail, but they won't keep you out of hell. But why wouldn't keeping the Ten Commandments make you more acceptable to God? It's simple. For we've all sinned. We all fall short of the glory of God. Keeping rules, depending on our own self-righteousness, feeling, I got this covered, would not give us the right to come into God's presence. Because clean living doesn't make us clean enough for God. Think about that for a moment. Clean living doesn't make us clean enough for God. In Hebrews 11, which is called the faith chapter, tells us of some great men and women of the Old Testament. I like it because if you read it, it's like a who's who of the Old Testament greats. It's the Old Testament version of the Hall of Fame of faith. But at the end of the chapter, this is what we're told. God had planned something better for us, Christians, so that only together with us would they, these Old Testament saints, be made perfect. The Old Testament saints, I mean, these were great people. These were unbelievable people. They are Hall of Fame people. But they lacked one thing that we have. One thing these Old Testament people never had a chance. We have Jesus. But that's not all. There's something we have as Christians because we have Jesus Christ. Earlier in the book of Hebrews, we're told of one important advantage of having Christ in our lives. And it says, this is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their heart and I will write them on their minds. Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, there is no longer any sacrifice for sin. We're taking away all those sacrifices. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place because of the blood of Jesus Christ, by a new and living way open for us through the curtain that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, I love this, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Did you catch that? The key part. We get to draw near to God. We are allowed to be drawn near of God. Because of Jesus Christ, we have confidence to enter the most holy place and boldly approach the throne of God. The Israelites at Mount Sinai were not even allowed to touch the mountain. They weren't holy enough to come into God's presence. But now, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, we are allowed to. We can what they couldn't. We get to get close and personal with God. But not because we've kept a bunch of laws. Not because we followed everything exactly and tried to live a clean life. We can come in the presence of God only because God has done something new in our lives. As it says in Romans, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life. 2 Corinthians tells us, if anyone in Christ is a new, he is a new creation. The old is gone and a new has come. But how is that God could take someone who is so messed up? How can God take someone whose life is all apart? How can God do this and make them new again? How does that work? It's only through the blood of Jesus Christ. I wish I could explain it even better, but I sure know it works. Trust me on that one. Trust the Bible on that one. That's how the whole thing works. There's a neat story, a true story here about Queen Victoria of England. And a lot of times she would go incognito and she would go to different shops and stuff through London and hope people didn't know who she was. On one such occasion, she went to a paper mill. The foreman wasn't sure who she was, but he knew she was somebody very distinguished. He showed her and her attendants that were with her throughout the whole plant. And at the very end, basically, they came to a room that was completely filled with trash. Trash gathered from all the city garbage from the city. As the queen watched this, she saw men picking through the garbage and finding these dirty, filthy rags. And she asked, why were they doing this? And the foreman explained that once the rags were sorted out, those rags would make the finest white paper. After her departure, the foreman found out it was the Queen of England. And sometimes later, the Queen received a package of the most delicate white stationery with her picture embossed on it. It was the Queen's likeness. It was unbelievable how beautiful this was. And a letter explained this, that the stationery had been made from the dirtiest of rags she had seen at the plant. But the process they used turned old, worthless pieces of rags into an unbelievable, beautiful stationery, worthy of a queen. And that illustrates what Christ does for us. Christ takes our filth. Jesus Christ takes whatever we've done, as wrong as we did, as awful things as we did, he now takes it and he makes us a new creation. He creates us now worthy of a king. When we're baptized into Jesus Christ, what do? We put on Jesus Christ. And when that happens, we are different than we ever were before. Just like that pure paper was made from awful, dirty rags, Jesus Christ can do that for us. We can put him in our lives and we can be changed. You see, God has rescued the Israelites from Egypt and now has taken them out of the desert. And now he wanted to enter into a relationship with them. He made a covenant with them. God had only good in store for his people. He wanted to give them this abundant land. He wanted to give them all these blessings. It was God who was going to give them hope, but it required obedience. We need to remember who we are. We need to remember that we are children of God. You have been bought with the most precious commodity ever known. You've been bought with the blood of Jesus Christ. You have the Spirit of the living God now inside you. You're being equipped for an eternal assignment that will empower you to live in the presence of God. You've been set apart. You have a holy calling. We need to remember we are His. And we need to remember that this is Canaan. We are in the promised land. I'm not talking about geographically. I'm talking about spiritually. We are in the promised land. It's a land of grace. It is a land of hope. It's a land of freedom. It's a land of truth. It's a land of love. And it's a land of life. You see, once we enter this promised land that God has given us now, the devil has no jurisdiction over us. The devil acts as he has jurisdiction over us, but he does not. The devil will walk with swagger, and he's going to try to bring temptation, but it's not going to work. I love what James wrote in chapter 4. He said, so humble yourself, submit yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Resist him. Humble yourself. Decide now what you're going to say when you're going to be tempted. Choose obedience. Choose obedience in God's word. Choose obedience of what God can do for you. Submit yourself to Him. And boy, when you do, expect God's blessings. When you submit your problems, your anxieties, your hurts, your pains, and you give those to God, expect God's blessings. the blessings of a clean conscience, the blessings of a good night's sleep, the blessings of God's fellowship, the blessing of God's favor, and the blessing of God's unconditional love. There's no guarantee that life's going to be easy. It's not going to happen. But what this is, it's an assurance that God is there to help. That God is there. Give me those concerns. Give me what you have. Put those in my lap. I got it. Because I will bless you. I love who you are. Psalms says this: good people suffer many troubles, but the Lord saves them from all of them. He is there for us. When we leave here today, may you hear the right voice. When you leave here today, may you make the right choices. When you leave here today, may you enjoy the blessings upon blessings. To take the time to just to stop and be still and see the great thing that God has done. When we put it in His hands and take a step out of that and just realize, look what God has done. Look at the opportunities. This is how the Old Testament works for us. This is a story of Moses and how he received God's law on this mountain, a mountain of freedom. And when we give our lives to Jesus Christ, when we trust in Him, all of a sudden, we have now are living on that mountain of freedom. It's through this way that God has given us. Because so many times in life we get weighed down. We don't know what to do. We can't break the chains of things that are holding us down. Being something small that to you it might be a 2-ton chain to something that's so huge, which is a 2-ton chain. And we don't know how to handle it. And God said, give it to me. And when we give it to Him, we know that He can break those chains. He can give us a different way to look at things. He can give us a new way to live. When we accept Him as our Lord and Savior, when we give our lives to Him in the waters of baptism and say, I want to be new. I want this life. I want to see things the way you want me to see them. This all started with Moses going to the mountain. And God said, I got something for you. I got something that's going to change your lives. If you obey. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our dear precious Heavenly Father, we just come to you thanking you for who you are. The lessons that you give us in your book are amazing. And sometimes we look through them and we don't get them, but when we study them, it's amazing the lessons that are giving us. From thousands and thousands of years ago, they apply to us this very moment. To accept you, to obey you, to follow you, and to trust in you and your promises, dear Heavenly Father. It's amazing the life we can have. We know it's not going to be easy, but we know we can get through these things when we put it in your hands. So we're here today as sinners who struggle sometimes. We're going to put this in your hands, dear Heavenly Father, because you know, we know you'll take them. We ask for strength to do so. We ask for courage to continue to do so, dear God. We pray for wisdom. We pray that as we get in your words, we understand. Give us an understanding. But more importantly, we ask that you allow us to be a witness for you. We ask that you give us so much enthusiasm to have you within us, to feel that spirit of you. Who's always there. Let us feel that, dear God, as we leave here. And for every step we take from here on, let it be steps towards you. Give us that ability to do so. We love you, and we know you love us. Sometimes we question, why would you ever love us? But you do because you tell us we are your creation. You love us because you sent your Son to die for us. You love us because you want us to spend eternity with you. And thank you for that. We praise your name and we give you all the glory. It's your name that we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we sing our invitation.
Draw me close to you. your place, to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find my way.